especially to thank someone who's not here tonight. It's John Wells, who's the keeper of manuscripts, who has prepared these exhibitions for me and prepared this evening's events. But unfortunately, he has a family funeral to attend, so he can't come tonight. But he's done a terrific job. And I also want to thank Francesca Harper and Mario Lane and Sharon Caitlin, who helped me with the preparation of the manuscript exhibition. So it's been a sort of terrific experience for me, actually. I've not done anything quite like this before. I thought what I would do is read a lot of Tom's poems and kind of talk between them rather than give you a lecture. I thought it would be more interesting that I should do something fairly spontaneous. So I've not over-prepared this. And the obvious place to start, I think, is by looking at the poem which figures as the first poem in nearly all Tom's collections and selections, which is a poem called The Wound. And it's, I think he thought of it as a kind of introduction to his work. It was written when he was an undergraduate at Trinity College, Cambridge. It's clearly inspired by his studies at the time. It's obviously influenced by Troilus and Cressida. In that play, if you remember, Achilles and Patroclus are pretty frankly represented as homosexual lovers. And Tom's gay, and he identified, I think, with something in that relationship. For those of you who don't have a thorough classical education, can I remind you that Neoptolemus was the son of Achilles and the person who led the attack on Troy when it was burnt to the ground in the story. And that Thersites is a cynical rogue who comments in Shakespeare sarcastically on events. The wound. The huge wound in my head began to heal about the beginning of the seventh week. Its valleys darkened. Its villages became still. Waiting, I did not move and dared not speak. Not doctors would cure it, but time, its patient skill. And constantly my mind returned to Troy. After I sailed the seas, I fought in turn on both sides, sharing even Helen's joy of place, and growing up to see Troy burn as Neoptolemus, that stubborn boy. I lay and rested, as prescription said, maneuvered with the Greeks, or sallied out each day with Hector. Finally, my bed became Achilles' tent, to which the lout Thersites came reporting numbers dead. I was myself, subject to no man's breath. My own commander was my enemy. And while my belt hung up, sword in the sheath, Thersites shambled in and breathlessly cackled about my friend Patroclus' death. I called for armor, rose, and did not reel. But when I thought, rage at his noble pain flew to my head, and turning, I could feel my wound break open wide. Over again, I had to let those storm-lit valleys heal. Tom Gunn was born in Gravesend in Kent in 1929. He spent part of his childhood in Kent, part of it in Hampstead, where he went to University College School. He came up to study at Trinity College, Cambridge in 1950, after 2 years national service. His life as a young man, his whole life in fact, was overshadowed by an immensely tragic event, the suicide of his mother when he was 15, and he and his younger brother found her dead body. We shall return to that later on. That was a crucial event, And one of the most fundamental things about his work, I think, is his sense of the importance of life to, sorry, the importance of literature to life. His mother had always taught him that literature was an important part of life, as a commentary on life. And it's my impression that he was able to cope with losing his mother, partly by visiting her in literature, by being able to share the experiences they'd shared while he was a child, in imagination when she was no longer with him. And so by the time he came up to Cambridge, he was 15 when she died, by the time he came up to Cambridge, he was, superficially at any rate, a secure and able young man. I think greatly troubled in many ways, but in Cambridge he discovered his sexuality and fell in love and began writing momentous poetry, publishing his first book in 1954 when he was 25. Nearly all the poems in that book, you have to remember, of course, when you did national service, you began university rather later. Nearly all the poems in that first book were written while he was an undergraduate. Fighting Terms is the name of it. That image of the soldier features in the poem I just read, where the soldier is partly Achilles, the traditional hero, but also partly the conscript, the ordinary national serviceman dreaming of Achilles. After Cambridge, he won a scholarship to go and study at Stanford University in California, where he was taught by an extraordinary and remarkable man, Ivor Winters, critic and poet. And he also went to California with the young man he'd fallen in love with in Cambridge. And gradually, as a result of these experiences, he decided to stay there. So from 1954 onwards, he lived in America, so he never became an American citizen. Under Winters, he wrote extensively and published his second book in 1957, which very much marked with Winters' influence. And I thought I would read what is probably Gunn's most famous poem, which is the first poem from that book, The Sense of Movement, which is called On the Move. It's a poem about motorcycle gangs, and it's very much influenced by two things, I think. One is Marlon Brando's film, The Wild One, which had just come out, that sort of myth of the wild motorcyclist. And an essay by Jean-Paul Sartre called Existentialism and Humanism. An essay which Gunn identified with very deeply, became briefly, though not conclusively, an existentialist. On the Move. The blue jay scuffling in the bushes follows some hidden purpose, and the gust of birds that spurts across the field, the wheeling swallows, have nested in the trees and undergrowth. Seeking their instinct or their poise or both, one moves with an uncertain violence under the dust thrown by baffled sense, or the dull thunder of approximate words. On motorcycles up the road they come, small, black, as flies hanging in heat, the boys, until the distance throws them forth, their hum bulging to thunder held by calf and thigh. In goggles donned in personality, in gleaming jackets trophied with the dust, they strap in doubt, by hiding it robust, and almost hear a meaning in their noise. Exact conclusion of their hardiness has no shape yet, but from known whereabouts they ride, direction where the tires press. They scare a flight of birds across a field, much that is natural to the will must yield. Men manufacture both machine and soul, and use what they imperfectly control to dare a future from the taken roots. It is a part solution, after all. one is not necessarily discord on earth, or damned because half animal, one lacks direct instinct, because one wakes afloat on movement that divides and breaks. One joins the movement in a valueless world, choosing it till both hurler and the hurled, one moves as well, always toward. A minute holds them who have come to go, the self-defined astride the created will, they burst away. The towns they travel through, a home to neither bird nor holiness, for birds and saints complete their purposes. At worst, one is in motion, and at best, reaching no absolute in which to rest. One is always nearer by not keeping still. That became the poem which captured Gunn's image for the public at a time when he was enormously successful and famous. But his fame rather faded in the course of his life. Not that he ever became an insignificant figure. He was always a prominent figure in English poetry, but he ceased to be quite as popular. And part of that was possibly something to do by being absorbed into California and becoming partly an American, but perhaps not sufficiently an American to be an identifiable character for an American audience. But it also accompanies a number of changes in his own character, I suppose one would want to say. He becomes a much gentler person as a result of settling in America. The sort of rather heavy masculinity of the poem that I've just read becomes very much modified as he develops. And in about around 1960, he began developing a new technique for writing, the syllabic poem, a poem which is written by counting the number of syllables in the line rather than the number of stresses or feet. And so actually the movement of the poem is much closer to prose. It's a kind of relaxed, casual movement, which is hospitable to casual impressions. And I'm going to read one of those poems, which I sort of think, I'm not absolutely sure about this, but I think it was probably written partly as a sort of response to On the Move, almost like a kind of critique of it. And it's called Considering the Snail. Contrast a snail with a motorcyclist, you see what I'm getting at. Considering the snail. The snail pushes through a green night, for the grass is heavy with water, and meets over the bright path he makes, where rain has darkened the earth star. He moves in a wood of desire, pale antlers barely stirring as he hunts. I cannot tell what power is at work, drenched there with purpose, knowing nothing. What is a snail's fury? All I think is that if later I parted the blades above the tunnel and saw the thin trail of broken white across litter, I would never have imagined the slow passion to that deliberate progress. I'm going to sort of bring myself a little bit into the story now. You see that I put some letters out at the end. I met Tom Gunn, I worked out just recently, almost exactly 53 years ago. I was an undergraduate in my first year at Cambridge. I was already a fan. And to my immense delight, my director of studies sent us all a card one day saying, you were invited to come and hear Mr. Tom Gunn read his poems. And so we went to hear him read his poems. And I was already pretty impressed. I was really knocked out. And when I saw him. And he was reading new poems which I had not read before, which were illuminating. Particularly read sections from something I can't read tonight, his long work, Misanthropos, which I think is one of the finest things he did, but it's a book-length poem. And I met Tom afterwards, and by various means we became friends, and stayed friends until he died in 2004. And so I was conscious of the way he was thinking around the time he wrote the next book, which is called Touch, published in 1967. And it was very much in his mind how one could become, having established this rather heroic image of himself, how one could gradually become more humane. The key poem in this process, I think, is a poem called Touch, title poem of the next book, which is an extraordinary poem. It was the first poem he wrote which is in completely free verse, and it's the kind of free verse that William Carlos Williams wrote, who was becoming a big influence at the time. Very, very tentative, full of passing perceptions, in a sense not monumental in the way that On the Move is, but reaching for discovery, exploring, trying to find out, and the process of looking being somehow embodied in the poem. So very often with very weak line endings, which give you a feeling of tentativeness and hesitation. Touch. You are already asleep. I lower myself in next to you, my skin slightly numb with the restraint of habit, the patina of self, the black frost of outsideness, so that even unclothed it is a resilient, chilly hardness, a superficially malleable, dead, rubbery texture. You are a mound of bedclothes, where the cat in sleep braces its paws against your calf through the blankets and kneads each paw in turn. Meanwhile and slowly, I feel is it my own warmth surfacing, or the ferment of your whole body that in darkness beneath the cover is stealing bit by bit to break down that chill? You turn and hold me tightly. Do you know who I am, or am I your mother, or the nearest human being to hold on to in a dreamed pogrom? What I now loosened sink into is an old big place. It is there already, for you are already there, and the cat got there before you, yet it is hard to locate. What is more, the place is not found, but seeps from our touch in continuous creation, dark enclosing cocoon round ourselves alone, dark wide realm where we walk with everyone. I thought perhaps, by way of pause, I might read a poem by somebody other than Tom Gunn. Something that Tom used to do in his own readings was read works by people he'd recently become interested in. And I thought I'd read in the course of this a couple of poems by poets who influenced him a great deal. That poem, it seems to me, though it's not obviously the case, is thinking about a famous poem by John Donne. If you think of it, It's a poem, the one I've just read, about falling asleep. It's therefore, in a sense, what you call strictly a serenade, a poem about the evening. And it contrasts with the sort of poem which is called an aubade, which is a poem of the dawn, a poem about waking up. And the most famous poem in English, I would think, about waking up is The Good Morrow by John Donne. And I'm sure he has that poem in mind. The Good Morrow. I wonder by my troth what thou and I did till we loved. Were we not weaned till then, but sucked on country pleasures childishly? Or snorted we in the seven sleepers' den? 'Twas so. But this, all pleasure's fancies be. If ever any beauty I did see which I desired and got, 'twas but a dream of thee. And now, good morrow to our waking souls, which watch not one another out of fear, for love all love of other sights controls, and makes one little room and everywhere. Let's see, travellers, let's see, discoverers, to new worlds have gone. Let maps to other worlds on worlds have shown. Let us possess one world. Each hath one and is one. My face in thine eye, thine in mine appears, and true plain hearts do in the faces rest. Where can we find two better hemispheres, without sharp north, without declining west? Whatever dies was not mixed equally. If our two loves be one, or thou and I, love so alike that none do slacken, none can die. We're moving on now in the 1960s, and we come to the Summer of Love, if any of you are old enough to remember that great occasion. California, in the days of psychedelia, free concerts in the Golden Gate Park, LSD, and so on. And we come to Tom Gunn's 1971 collection, Moly, which is a book influenced by the drug LSD, which he and friends experimented with during a longish period. LSD is obviously a hallucinatory drug, but those who take it, I've never taken it myself, but those who take it say it's also an illuminating drug. And that certainly seems to have been its effect on Gunn. Moly, just to remind you, I'm sure everybody knows what Moly is the drug the herb in the Odyssey, which Hermes gives to Odysseus when Circe has turned Odysseus's sailors into pigs. Moly is something he eats which preserves him against Circe's magic. In other words, preserves his humanity. And this is a kind of trope for LSD in the book. I'm looking for a note. I'm going to read two books from Moly, two poems from Moly. Moly is my favourite of all Tom's books. I'll read the first poem, which is called Rites of Passage. This is a poem covertly, I think, about Gunn's parents. Gunn was, as I've suggested, extremely close to his mother and had a very bad relationship with his father. And in this poem, he imagines himself, dreams himself, being turned into a horned animal, emerging from adolescence, as it were. Strange poem. Rites of Passage. Something is taking place. Horns bud bright in my hair. My feet are turning hoof. And father, see my face. Skin that was damp and fair is bark-like and feel rough. See, grey top, how I shine. I rear, break loose, I neigh, snuffing the air, and harden toward a completion mine. And next I make my way, adventuring through your garden. My play is earnest now. I canter to and fro. My blood, it is like light. Behind an almond bough, horns gaudy with its snow, I wait live out of sight. All planned before my birth, for you, old man, no other, whom your groin's trembling warms. I stamp upon the earth a message for my mother, and then I lower my horns. I suppose it's a kind of reading of Freudian psychology and the Oedipus complex and so on, but it's a great deal more than that. The other poem I'm going to read from Mowgli is a song. Gunn was a great writer of songs, I think, like Elizabethan songs. And this poem is very, I shall in a minute read you an Elizabethan song that goes with it. But this is about a sort of classic San Francisco drug dealer selling drugs on the street. And it evokes, I think, in a modern way, the world of the Elizabethan street call, street cry, street seller's song. And a few things that you might not know. The refrain is keys, lids, acid, and speed. Keys and lids means kilograms and pounds. And I'm sure you know acid and speed. Street song. I am too young to grow a beard. But yes, man, it was me you heard. In dirty denim and dark glasses. I look through everyone who passes, but ask him clear, I do not plead. Keys, lids, acid and speed. My grass is not oregano. Some of it grew in Mexico. You cannot guess the weed I hold. Clara green, Acapulco gold, Panama red, you name it, man. Best on the street since I began. My methadrine, my double sun, will give you two lives in your one, 5 days of power before you crash, at which time use these lumps of hash. They burn so sweet, they smoke so smooth, they make you sharper while they soothe. Now here, the best I've got to show, made by a righteous cat I know, pure acid. It will scrape your brain and make it something else again. Call it heaven, call it hell. Join me and see the world I sell. Join me and I will take you there. Your head will cut out from your hair into whichever self you choose. With midday McMahon, you can't lose. I'll get you anything you need. Keys. Lids, acid, and speed. Tom quite often said that he had been thinking about Elizabethan song when he wrote that, and overwhelmingly the poem I think he had in mind was a song by John Dowland. Dowland's songs are, as poems, I think, extremely remarkable, and nobody really knows who wrote them. My own suspicion, I think it was Tom's as well, is that Dowland probably wrote them himself, which would make Dowland a forgotten great poet, actually. This is a song about a street peddler who sells knickknacks, love tokens, cheap things to give to your lady as a gift. Fine knacks for ladies. fine knacks for ladies, cheap, choice, brave, and new. Good pennyworths, but money cannot prove. I keep a fair but for the fair to view. A beggar may be liberal of love. Though all my wares be trash, the heart is true. Great gifts are guiles and look for gifts again. My trifles come as treasures from my mind. It is a precious jewel to be plain. Sometimes in shell the Orient's pearls we find. Of others take a sheaf, of me a grain. Within this pack, pins, points, laces and gloves, and divers toys fitting a country fair. But in my heart where duty serves and loves, turtles and twins, courts brood, a heavenly pair. Happy the heart that thinks of no removes. I wish I could sing that, but I'm afraid I can't sing. Happiness musically. I'm now going to read. Tom went sort of back and forth between writing in free verse and writing in meter. And I'm going to read two poems from written in the 1970s, which are very obviously in free verse, in a very American kind of free verse. First one is rather obviously technically influenced by Walt Whitman. And it's about a dog. It's called Yoko. He was very conscious that good, once said to me, he was very conscious that good poems had been written by a number of poets about animals. He was thinking of Ted Hughes's poems, and he was thinking of Marianne Moore's poems and D.H. Lawrence's poems. But none of them, he said, ever tell you what the animal thinks. And so this is a poem about what the animal thinks. So a friend of his had a Newfoundland dog in New York, which is where this poem is set. And these are the thoughts of the dog, Yoko. All today, I lie in the bottom of the wardrobe, feeling low, but sometimes getting up to moodily lumber across rooms and lap from the toilet bowl. It is so sultry. And then I hear the noise of firecrackers again. All New York is jaggedy with firecrackers today. And I go back to the wardrobe, gloomy, trying to void my mind of them. I am confused. I feel loose and unfitted. At last, deep in the stairwell, I hear a tread. It is him, my leader, my love. I run to the door and listen to his approach. Now I can smell him. What a good man he is. I love it when he has the sweat of work on him. As he enters, I yodel with happiness. I throw my body up against his. I try to lick his lips. I care about him more than anything. After we eat, we go for a walk to the piers. I leap into the standing warmth. I plunge into the combination of old and new smells. Here on a garbage can at the bottom. So interesting. What sister or brother, I wonder, left this message, I sniff. I too piss there and go on. Here a hydrant, there a pole. Here's a smell I left yesterday. Well, that's disappointing. But I piss there anyway and go on. I investigate so much that in the end it is for form's sake only. Only a drop comes out. I investigate tar and rotten sandwiches, everything, and go on. And here, a dried old turd, so interesting, so old, so dry, yet so subtle and mellow. I can place it finely. I really appreciate it. A gold, distant smell, like packed autumn leaves in winter, reminding me how what is rich and fierce when excreted becomes weathered and mild. But always interesting, and reminding me of what I have to do. My leader looks on and expresses his approval. I sniff it well, and later I sniff the air well. The wind is meeting us after the close July day. Rain is getting near too, but first the wind. Joy, joy, being outside with you, active, investigating it all, with bowels emptied, feeling your approval, and then running on the big fleet Yoko. My body in its excellent black coat never lets me down, returning to you, as I always will, you know that. And now, filling myself out with myself, no longer confused, my panting pushing apart my black lips, but unmoving, I stand with you, braced against the wind. And here's Thomas was somebody who went on about the life of the streets. He loved cities, and he loved simply walking about and observing what happens there. And he took a great interest in people who live on the streets, the sort of derelicts, the dropouts of society, beggars and homeless people, and so on. And this is a poem about someone of that kind, or at least I imagine it is. It's called Sweet Things. Sweet things. He licks the last chocolate ice cream from the scabbed corners of his mouth. Sitting in the sun on a step outside the laundromat, Mongoloid Don turns his crew cut head and spies me coming down the street. Hi, he says. He says it with the mannered enthusiasm of a fraternity brother. Take me across the street? Part question, part command. I hold the sticky bunch of small fingers in mine, and we stumble across. They sell peaches and pears over there. The juice will dribble down your chin. He turns before I leave him, saying abruptly, with the same mixture of order and request, give me a quarter. I don't give it, never have, not to him. I wonder why not. And as I walk on alone, I realize it's because his unripened mind never recognizes me, me for myself. He only says hi for what he can get, quarters to buy sweet things, one after another. He goes from store to store, from candy store to ice cream store to bakery to produce market, unending quest for the palate's pleasure. Then out to Panhandle again, more quarters, more sweet things. My errands are toothpaste, vitamin pills, and a book of stamps. No self-indulgence there. But who's this coming up? It's John. No, Chuck. How could his name have slipped my mind? Chuck gives a one-sided smile. He stands as if fresh from a laundromat, a scrubbed cowboy, Tom Sawyer grown up, yet stylish, perhaps even careful, his dark hair slicked back in the latest manner. When he shakes my hand, I feel a dry finger playfully bending inward and touching my palm in secret. It's a long time since we got together, says John. Chuck, I mean. The warm, teasing tickle in the cave of our handshake took my mind off toothpaste, snatched it off indeed. How handsome he is in his lust and energy, in his fine display of impulse. Boldly, how about now, I say, knowing the answer. My boy, I could eat you whole. In the long pause, I gazed him up and down and from his blue sneakers back to the redawning one-sided smile. We know our charm. We know delay makes pleasure great. In our eyes, on our tongues, we savour the approaching delight of things we know yet afresh always. Sweet things, sweet things. I find that an enormously rewarding poem. It seems so slight when you first read it, and it's so rich. And some of my friends know I love the line, "We know delay makes pleasure great," which sounds like it might be from Dowland or Campion, and not from kind of loose American free verse poem. So in 1983, of course, things changed in Tom's life and in the life of California with the arrival of AIDS, and the arrival of a plague alters anybody's life, I imagine. And Gunn began to lose friends as they died. In the course of the 1980s, he wrote a whole series of poems lamenting the deaths of friends who had died from AIDS. And they were gathered together in the book called The Man with Night Sweats, which is one of his great achievements. Part of the magic of The Man with Night Sweats is his refusal of a complaining voice. They are very controlled and firm and rather reticent, but the reticence is precisely the thing one finds so moving, that somehow the emotion is too great to risk putting directly into words. There are two really very obvious influences on that book. One, I think, is probably Thomas Hardy, who I shall be saying something about in a minute. But more importantly than Hardy still, I think, is Ben Jonson, who was one of Gunn's two or three favorite poets, a poet who tends to be better known nowadays as a dramatist. But Gunn particularly loved his poetry, and I'm just going to read a little poem of Jonson's by way of introduction to The Man with Night Sweats. This is Jonson's poem on the death of his first son, age 7. And you have to know, if you don't know the poem already, I imagine many of you do, you have to know that the name Benjamin means child of my right hand. So Jonson was called Benjamin, and presumably his first son was as well. On his first son, "Farewell, thou child of my right hand, and joy. My sin was too much hope of thee, loved boy. 7 years thou wert lent to me, and I thee pay, exacted by thy fate on the just day. Oh, could I lose all father now? For why will man lament the state he should envy? To have so soon scaped world's and flesh's rage, and if no other misery, yet age. Rest in soft peace, and asked, say, here doth lie Ben Jonson, his best piece of poetry, for whose sake henceforth all his vows be such, as what he loves may never like too much." One of the most moving of Gunn's elegies is a poem about a young man to whom he was very attached, a young man of 28 who died of AIDS, and who was himself a poet of considerable promise. And here is the poem in which he writes about him. It's called The J Car. You need to know the J Car is a streetcar line in San Francisco. I think of this poem as a kind of pastoral elegy. There are all kinds of hints that Gunn is thinking of poems like Milton's Lycidas. Last year, I used to ride the J Church line climbing between small yards recessed with vine, their ordered privacy, their plots of flowers, like blameless lives we might imagine ours. Most trees were cut back, but some brushed the car before it swung round to the street once more, on which I rolled out almost to the end, to 29th Street, calling for my friend. He'd be there at the door, smiling but gaunt, to set out for the German restaurant. There, since his sight was tattered now, I would first read the menu out. He liked the food in which a sourness and dark richness meet, for conflict without taste of a defeat, as in the Sauerbraten. What he ate, I hoped, would help him to put on some weight. But though the crusted pancakes might attract, it did so more as concept than in fact. And I'd eat his dessert before we'd both rose from the neat arrangement of the cloth, where the connection between life and food had briefly seemed so obvious, if so crude. Our conversation circumspectly cheerful. We had sat there like children, good but fearful, who think if they behave, everything might, still against likelihood, come out all right. But it would not, and we could not stay here. Finishing up the optimate of beer, I walked him home through the suburban cool, by dimming shape of church and Catholic school, only a few white teenagers about. After the four blocks, he would be tired out. I'd leave him to the feverish sleep ahead, myself to ride through darkened yards instead, back to my health. Of course, I simplify. Of course. It tears me still that he should die, as only an apprentice to his trade, the ultimate engagements not yet made. His gifts had been withdrawing one by one, even before their usefulness was done. This optic nerve would never be relit, the other flickered soon to be with it. Unready, disappointed, unachieved, he knew he would not write the much conceived, much hopeful work now, nor yet help create a love he might in full reciprocate. I'm going to read just one more poem. Which perhaps is in a similar vein. I think Garn had never set out to be an elegist. Elegies forced themselves upon him in a way. The experience of the AIDS epidemic overwhelmed him and almost forced him to write what he did. And he then acquired the habit of writing elegy. And in the mid-1990s, he came to the subject that he had always avoided, the subject of his mother's death, and wrote a poem about it. And I remember him saying that he discovered the only way to deal with it after 48 years, and it's written 48 years after her death, was to write it as if he wasn't part of the story. He wrote it in the third person. And this was a technique he'd noticed in Thomas Hardy, who I think, as I say, was the other great influence on Garn, apart from Ben Jonson. And in the Bancroft Library in Berkeley University, California, there is Tom's papers, which I've been through. And there, among the papers, I discovered his diary entry written at the age of 15. Describing the death of his mother the previous day, which I've reproduced in the notes for this book. It's extraordinarily touching, and it's quite clear that he must have consulted that diary in order to write this poem as a man in his 60s. Those of you who are young may perhaps not know what a gas poker is. It's a tube which you plug into the gas, and you light it, you light the gas, and then you put it under coal and it lights the fire for you. And people, they became enormously problematic because people committed suicide by breathing the gas out of them. And that's what Gunn's mother did. The gas poker. 48 years ago, can it be 48 since then? They forced the door, which she had barricaded with a full bureau's weight, lest anyone find, as they did, what she had blocked it for. She had blocked the doorway so, to keep the children out. In her red dressing gown, she wrote notes, all night busy pushing the things about, thinking till she was dizzy, before she had lain down. The children went to and fro on the harsh winter lawn, repeating their lament, a burden to each other in the December dawn, elder and younger brother, till they knew what it meant, knew all there was to know. Coming back off the grass to the room of her release, they who had been her treasures knew to turn off the gas, take the appropriate measures, telephone the police. One image from the flow sticks in the stubborn mind, a sort of backwards flute. The poker that she held up breathed from the holes aligned into her mouth till filled up by its music, she was mute. Thank you very much.
Bob Wilmer is very happy to take some questions. Could you please speak up so that you can hear them clearly? If there are any questions, please, would you like to raise your hand?
There don't have to be questions.
There's lots of questions. Of wine at the back. It's difficult to maybe to find a question after that very moving poem at the end.
I think we'll leave it there.
Can I just...
Something about him. He published his last book in 2000, when he was 71. And then he just went dry. So it was sort of about 4 years, three to four years. 4 years when he didn't really write anything. He tried a few, but they weren't successful. I mean, there's a sort of a mystery about this, actually. I was thinking about it a lot the other day. If you examine the last book, which is called Boss Cupid, which that poem is from, it's clearly designed as a farewell to the world. It's shaped, it ends up with him taking a bow at the very end of it, and it begins with an Ars Poetica. And it's the book which includes the poem I've just read, which is him dealing with the one experience he hadn't been able to deal with. So if he knew he was going to die, how is it that he somehow tried to write? He seemed he'd given up, but he hadn't given up. And it's sort of a puzzle to me. And he rather fell apart in his last 4 years. He lost his determination and his edge. And that the poem, it's a bit difficult, it's chicken and egg really. Was it losing the ability to write that caused that? Or was it becoming like that that caused him to be unable to write? I don't know. Yes. Connie.
Why did he move away from blank verse if he was interested in Elizabethan poetry?
Not blank. He didn't write blank verse at all, I don't think, or hardly at all. Rhymed verse he wrote, mostly. Why did he move away from it? I think he felt that there were things that free verse and syllabics did which you can't do in rhymed verse. And he'd seen, of course, living in America, he'd been very conscious of the what you might call the sort of freewheeling tradition in American poetry that comes from Pound and William Carlos Williams. And he just wanted to imitate that. The interesting thing is he never gave up writing in the manner that he started. He always alternated between writing in meter and writing in free verse. And he did actually say to me once that he felt he wrote better in meter than in free verse. And I think that's actually probably true, with a few exceptions. I think Tuck, for instance, is magnificent, and one among his four or five best poems. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Okay, wine. Thank you very much.